So good morning all of you. Today I will start a new chapter in VLSI technology course, that is metallization. It's a very important chapter. One of the reason of importance is this particular step comes at the end sequence of the VLSI process. So before that, lot of steps have been covered, a lot of processing have already been done. So after that, if some steps comes, then you have to be extremely cautious so that there should not be any error, there should not be any problem. So if there is any defect or any error in this particular stage, means end stages, so then you have to reject the complete set of wafers, the complete process. So a loss is more. Some problem or defect at the beginning stages means the processing cost up to that stage is not that much. But if something has to be rejected at the end stages, then problem is already before that lot of expenditure has been incurred to come to that stage. So loss is more. That's why in VLSI processing, when you are going for metallization, one has to extremely cautious so that there should not be any error, any defect, any problem in this particular process. And whatever the earlier processes are correct or wrong, its success basically comes from the contact and interconnect. If any problem in contact and interconnect, then you cannot get the result of testing. Before that, maybe everything was correct. May all diffusion and implantation or the alignment, etc., may be correct. But if there is a not a proper contact to the contact windows of different portions of the circuit, then you will not have the performance of the circuit. In that respect, also VLSI metallization means contact and interconnects in silicon ICs is an important topic in VLSI technology. Now, the metallization, we can define it. Metallization is a process that forms contact on devices and connects individual devices together by thin conductive metal films to form circuits. So instead of wire, which is used in breadboard circuits, in VLSI chips, we use thin conductive metal films as a connecting wires. Thin conductive metal films. At the same time, at the different electrodes, you have to have proper contacts on the device electrodes. What are those electrodes? In case of BJT, collector, base, and emitter, in case of MOS, source, drain, and gate. Particularly, you take contact on the source and drain region. Okay? Gate is not directly ohmic contact with the gate region. Gate electrode is not directly ohmic contact with the gate region, isn't it? So the ohmic contacts are required in source and drain region, and at the same time you need ohmic contact in the collector, base, and emitter region in a BJT. And lot of interconnection lines are also there in VLSI circuits. Now, the metal work function plays an important role in determining the current flow characteristics of the devices. And what are those currents? Drain currents in case of MOS or CMOS, collector, base, or emitter currents in case of BJT. It also determines the voltage required to activate the devices. I hope all of you know the metal work function, that is minimum amount of energy required to eject an electron from metal. So those electrons will take part in current conduction. So that's why this work function parameter is an important parameter, and it plays an important role in VLSI contacts and interconnects, means in current conduction mechanism, in the conducting film and conducting wires. So also this particular parameter is very important in determining the threshold voltage of MOS, you know. So that means there it does the work of the activation of the device. Threshold voltage means below which you cannot activate the device. So above threshold voltage you can activate the device in MOS. So that's why in this particular parameter work function is very important. That means the selection of metals is also important, because work function of different metals are different. And there is another contact required in some cases, which is known as Schottky contacts or Schottky diodes. There also the work function parameter is very important parameter. Okay, so when you are selecting a particular metal for either ohmic or the Schottky contact, then the work function is to be known, and you have to select such that your particular objective is fulfilled. Means whether you need ohmic, it will be ohmic, or when you need Schottky or rectifying contact, it will be rectified. Okay. Next point is, just now I told you there are two types of contact. One is known as ohmic contact, another is rectifying contact. In normal cases, we require ohmic contact. In a very specific cases, for specific applications, sometimes we need also Schottky contact. Then what is the difference between the ohmic and Schottky contacts? Ohmic contact, you know, in this particular type of contact mechanism, the current and voltage are linearly related. So current is directly proportional to the voltage, and it also true that whether the voltage, means if you bias a particular device, either forward or reverse, whatever it is, so that current voltage characteristics will be linear. That means if the voltage is positive or negative, the dependence on current and voltage will remain same. That means linear dependence. Okay. But in case of rectifying contact, it's not true. In case of rectifying contact, the current voltage relations are dependent on the bias. That means positive voltage and negative voltage, it does not show the same relationship of the IV. In forward bias, the IV relations are exponential in nature, not linear. But in reverse bias, up to certain voltage, we have seen the current is independent of the applied reverse voltage up to certain limit. And if you exceed that limit, then current exceeds enormously. That is the breakdown region, isn't it? So that is the rectifying contact. That means if you want to judge a particular contact, whether it is rectifying or ohmic, how can you do it? Just take a IV characteristics of that particular junction. Junction means that particular contact I am talking about here. The metal and semiconductor, that particular contact, if you take the IV relation, IV characteristics, then if you find either forward bias or reverse bias, the relationship does not change, then it is perfectly ohmic. But if you see that the reverse and forward bias, the characteristics changes enormously, then obviously the contact is rectifying contact. That is the way you can easily find out whether you got a proper ohmic contact or not. Okay? In normal cases, ohmic contact is required in VLSI metallization contacts. So you have to choose a certain material. That means you have to select work function of the material so that it will give you ohmic contacts. Okay? Now, again in VLSI, the contacts is made not only in n-type material, in p-n both. So when you are talking about ohmic contact to contacts, so it will show you the ohmic contact on p-type as well as on n-type also. That means you cannot use the sequence, does not permit you, process sequence does not permit you to have an ohmic contact in n region some material, to have an ohmic contact in the p region some different material. It doesn't permit you. That means you have to have certain technique, certain method, so that the same metal film will produce ohmic contact both on n region and p region. For that purpose, you may have to change the doping level of a particular layer, semiconductor layer. Okay, so that thing you have to keep in mind. Now, as devices are scaled down in VLSI, improved metallization schemes are evolved continuously. Although aluminium has been used as contact and interconnect material for a considerable amount of time. In earlier phases of metallization, people used the aluminium as a material for VLSI contact and interconnects. That is okay, quite a considerable amount of time, but in the last decade or end of the last decade, we can say the VLSI devices are scaled down in such a manner. So if we go metallization using only aluminium, it creates a lot of problem. So a lot of advanced VLSI metallization schemes are evolved day by day in order to prevent the problems of ultra shallow junctions, in order to have proper ohmic contact on shallow junction devices, and so on. Okay, those points we will discuss in this course subsequently, one by one, what are the various problems in VLSI contacts and interconnects, why aluminium is not a very good material for VLSI contacts, and what are the improvements obtained if we go for some other metallization schemes, and what are the different metallization schemes. Those we will discuss in due course when we proceed further on this particular topic, metallizations. Okay. Now, the metallization, what are the desired properties a metallization scheme should have? That means choice of materials. That means choice of metal film, choice of metal is very important consideration to have certain properties of metallization. Now let us discuss what are those properties one by one. First thing is low resistivity, means high conductance or high conductivity is required. That means the metallization scheme should produce very low resistance, means its conductivity should be high, otherwise there will be loss of power. Okay, and another is easy to form. The formation of that particular metal film should be easy. It should be compatible to the normal VLSI processes. You may not suggest certain film which is very difficult to deposit. For example, if we go for metallization in all layers using a tungsten metal. So tungsten metal film is not so easy to form because its melting point is extremely high, isn't it? So you have to have lot of thinking of lot of consideration you have to give so that the technique of evaporation or techniques of obtaining such films must not be very crucial and must not be very crucial to the ambient environment, must not be very difficult to obtain, and it must not take lot of time also. All these considerations you have to take care. Another is low contact resistance and non-rectifying contacts. So low resistivity and low contact resistance are different thing. Low resistivity means interconnect lines. And here, the contact resistance is another parameter, which is also very important. The resistance offered in the contact, that means silicon and metal contact will offer you certain resistance, which is known as contact resistance. That depends on the interface property of that silicon and aluminium or silicon or other metal interface. It depends on that, how much will be the contact resistance. Okay, and non-rectifying contacts in normal application, as I told you, mentioned that all the contacts should be non-rectifying in nature. Next is safe and controlled as required. The metal film must be safe and controlled as required. What does it mean basically? It must be lithographically compatible. That means you you have to see whether using that particular metal film you can have long narrow lines, not only width is small, but length should be very large, because interconnection lines may not be confined to a certain length. It may be 100 times or 1000 times more than the width length, isn't it? So that pattern is possible using normal lithography technique or not, that also you have to think. That means you can shape the interconnect lines as you desire, and it has to be controlled. Okay, what does it mean? Means you have to select certain materials whose etching is well standard. Etching of that metal film, either dry etching, means you have to have well aware, you have to know the what are the dry etching gases, and that dry etching gas can produce fine lines. Or if you go for wet etching, there also you have to know the proper etching solution, and at the same time that etching solution should not attack the photoresist. All these things are coming into the picture. That means safe and control as required. It's lithographically compatible, and lithographically compatible means all these points are coming into the picture. Next is, it has mutual solubility with silicon. To have a very good ohmic contact, mutual solubility is an important consideration. Mutual solubility means, for example, if I use aluminium metal, so the aluminium and silicon is mutually soluble. That means when I will anneal it after metallization pattern, at that temperature, annealing temperature, the aluminium or any other metal which you are going to use, that metal and the silicon will form microalloy at the interface level. So if it cannot form microalloy at the interface level, then you will not expect very good contact resistance. So in order to have very good contact resistance, you have to have good microalloying, and that is only possible if it is mutually soluble. That means at that sintering or annealing temperature, the metal and the silicon will be mutually soluble. Okay, so that is important for getting good ohmic contact. Now, penetrates thin native oxides. Why it is important? Penetrates thin native oxides. You know, the metallization film or metal film is deposited on the wafer after contact windows are opened in silicon. Silicon is a masking oxide for contact. Then using lithography, you open the contact window, and in the contact window means you will have the windows there, silicon is available, and others are protected. The other silicon layers are protected using silicon dioxide layer. That is a masking layer. So wherever the contact is there, bare silicon is available. We are assuming that, but it is not fact. After contact window, if you load all the wafers into the evaporation chamber or metallizing chamber, so during the transport of those wafers into the metallizing chamber, a very thin native oxide will form, and that native oxide is thickness is of the order of, say, 2 to 5 angstrom. In some cases it may go up to 8 angstrom also. This is a very thin layer. This is because the silicon has very good affinity with oxygen. Even in the ambient, with the ambient oxygen, it will form a very thin layer of silicon dioxide, and that is known as native oxide. Even at room temperature, that thickness is very small, of the order of, as I mentioned, 3 to 5 angstrom unit. So that thin silicon, native silicon dioxide, has to be penetrated so that good ohmic contact is formed. So whatever the metal film you are depositing, that metal film will have the capability of penetration of that native oxide, puncturing that native oxide, So good OMI contact is formed. That is important consideration. Okay, if it cannot penetrate, then you cannot expect good OMI contact. So that is why every time when we load the wafers into the metallization chamber, we rinse or you dip the wafers in very dilute hydrofluoric acid, about 1% to 2% diluted hydrofluoric acid, we rinse all the wafer so that whatever native oxide is formed, that is removed, and then we load. And after the dilute HF rinse, we don't again wash it in deionized water. If you wash it in deionized water, again the native oxide thickness will increase. So in the metallization stage, after contact windows are open, after cleaning is over, we give dilute HF diff for all the wafers, then directly the wafers are loaded into the metallization chamber. Even during the transportation from the cleaning bench to the metallization instrument or chamber, a native oxide will be formed. And that is very thin 2 to 5 angstrom unit. So that means the metal must have some capability of penetrating the thin native oxide. Now, another consideration is mechanical stability. The mechanical stability means here good adhesion and low stress. Good adhesion and low stress. The metal film you are depositing on the wafer for making interconnect lines. The interconnect lines will run on silicon dioxide, and for making contact means metal film will be in touch with the silicon. That means the good adhesion is required both in silicon as well in silicon dioxide. The metal film must have good adherence property with silicon as well as silicon dioxide. Otherwise, the whole thin film will peel off from the surface and you cannot pattern it. Okay. And next is the low stress. That is another mechanical property. Low stress means the film, the metal film, should not produce high stress on silicon and silicon dioxide. If stress is formed, then what will happen? You may face micro cracks in the film. Micro cracks. That how again stress is formed? Stress is formed because of mismatch of the thermal expansion coefficient of the film and the underneath silicon and silicon dioxide. Because of that, stress may form. I will discuss the stress part in detail. Because of the stress, what are the problems normally found in metallization process? I will discuss it. So we have to see that stresses are not developed. And if stresses are developed, you may have crack in the film which lead to the open circuiting of the interconnect lines. That means you may not get direct contact from one point to other if there is a micro crack. Okay. Now, the next point is metallurgically compatible with silicon, other metals and passivation. Metallurgically compatible with silicon, other metals and passivation. Why other metals? Metallurgically compatible with silicon is okay. That means you can form a microalloy, good adhesion. That is the metallurgically compatible. So with silicon and silicon dioxide, understood. But why with other metals? Other metals compatibility is required because in nowadays in VLSI, only single level of metallization is not done. In multi-level metallization also done. And at the same time, in the same level, sometimes you go for multi-layer metallization. In the same level, first level, second level, third level, different level of metallization. And in between different levels, you have to have a dielectric layer to insulate the metal, layer 1 metal to layer 2 metal. So even in a particular layer may not be, but sorry, particular level of metallization, the layer may not be single, layer may be multiple. That means multiple layers, one layer is say gold and then chromium, then sometimes come say aluminium, and sometimes give titanium, aluminium, sometimes molybdenum, titanium, aluminium. So those different combinations are used in the same level of metallization, obviously for certain reason. And one of the reason just I mentioned earlier is the reduce the stress. Because if the metal film and the silicon material or silicon dioxide has large mismatch of expansion coefficient, then you have to have a barrier layer in between, which is intermediate thermal expansion coefficient, so that it will reduce stress. And sometimes we may face some other problems. That means interdiffusion. So there are certain metal schemes available where the layer one interdiffuses in layer two. If interdiffusion is much, then it may create some another alloy metal layer whose conductivity is not that much high. So in order to prevent that interdiffusion between two layers, you may have to have a third layer, which is in between these two layers, which will prevent interdiffusion of first layer and the third layer. The second layer, you put it as an interdiffusion layer. So similarly, the stack of layers are formed to have good ohmic contact as well as good conductivity of the metal lines. Okay, so that's why the metals must have metallurgically compatible with other metals. And then passivation is the last stage. After metallization is over, then a passivated layer or insulating layer is formed in order to protect the whole IC from the environment. That means there we are protecting the complete IC using a dielectric film, that is passivation layer. So that passivation layer has to be compatible with the metal film, because that passivation layer is formed on the top of the metal film. If the metal film and the passivation layer is not metallurgically compatible, that means in between there is a thin layer of air or dielectric may form, so that will damage the whole thing, isn't it? That means metallurgically compatible means it has to be, adherence should be good, it has to be over thin layer, it is soluble, etc., etc. Okay, so next point is it should not contaminate devices, wafers or working apparatus. That means you cannot choose a particular metal film which contaminate devices or it contaminate the whole wafers and systems and working apparatus. Okay, so that has to be taken care. Minimal junction penetration and low electromigration. So this is again an important consideration when you select a particular material. Minimal junction penetration. So if that metal film penetrates a large thickness in silicon, then it may happen that it may reaches up to the junction, underneath junction, and it may sort the junction. So that should not be there. Minimal junction penetration and low electromigration. Electromigration is a problem, failure mechanism in VLSI. I will discuss in depth and detail in this particular problem. Basically, it's a failure mechanism, electromigration. Okay. Now, materials for contacts and interconnects. Now, we'll discuss different contacts and interconnects materials and their advantages and disadvantages. First is aluminium. Since aluminium is widely used material over the long period of time in VLSI process, first let us consider on aluminium. Aluminium, most common in interconnect contact material. It has low resistivity. Its resistivity varies in the range of 2.7 to 3 micro ohm centimeter. Ideally, its value is 2.7 micro ohm centimeter. And for 1 micron thick film, it gives 0.03 ohm per square seat resistance for 1 micron thick layer. Aluminium has got excellent adherence to oxides. Adherence to aluminium is must. Also, you need adherence to the oxides because interconnect lines run over the oxide layer. good ohmic contact to silicon. Aluminium shows good ohmic contact to both P and N type silicon. In case of P type silicon, there is no problem, but in case of N type silicon, for getting very good ohmic contact, the doping concentration of N layer is more, is made more, N plus. Wherever you need N type layer ohmic contact with aluminium, then that N layer concentration is increased. Okay, that means N plus and P forms very good ohmic contact with aluminium. Those are the advantages of aluminium. DC magnetron sputtering for high deposition rates. That means thick aluminium film can be deposited using DC magnetron sputtering unit. That is one advantage of aluminium, which is not possible in many of the metal film. Okay, now gold. All of us know that gold is a very good noble metal. It doesn't react with other metal easily, and it has very high conductivity. But in VLSI metallization, gold is not a popular material because obviously certain reason, although it has high conductivity compared to other materials, even then it is not used in silicon VLSI much. But sometimes, it is not sometimes, in case of 3-5 semiconductor, for getting ohmic contact, chromium gold is one of the choicest material, chrome gold. In case of gallium arsenide ohmic contact, we use it. There aluminium is not sufficient material. What are the problems and what are the advantages of gold? Let us see. Gold is very inert because it doesn't react with ambient gases, other things. It adheres poorly. That is, it's one of the biggest disadvantages. Adherence of gold with the silicon as well as silicon dioxide is very much poor. That is extremely a disadvantage. Low resistivity, that is advantage. Its resistivity is 2.5 microohm centimeter. And for 1 micron thick gold film, the seed resistance of gold is observed as 0.025 ohm per square. That is the seed resistance. Used widely for gallium arsenide interconnects. It is popular in gallium arsenide. But there also, to improve the adherence of the gold film, we always use, in case of gold, an adhesion promoter or adhesion layer, adhesion that is chromium. Wherever you need a gold, it's coupled with chromium. Chromium initially, thin layer of the order of say 500 angstrom, then you use 1 micron gold. And that chromium helps adherence of gold film with the semiconducting layer, semiconductor substrate. So, just few minutes back I mentioned the metal film has to be compatible with other material. So here is one application. Strongly gold will not do your job. You have to use the chromium and gold together. Okay. So now, other than aluminium and the gold, what are the other things used in VLSI interconnects? That is, one is polysilicon. Although polysilicon is not a metal, we know polycrystalline silicon is a semiconductor. The polycrystalline in nature, not single crystal, but this polycrystalline silicon may be used as an interconnect or contact material. Particularly in case of CMOS technology, polysilicon used as a gate material on oxide. On oxide polysilicon and on top polysilicon you can use some metal. The polysilicon film, normally its conductivity is very low because it is a semiconducting material, semiconductors. Silicon. So, in order to increase this conductivity, it is doped. The polycrystalline silicon film is doped with either N-type or P-type dopant, and after adequate incorporation of dopant atoms, we find the polysilicon conductivity increases and it is of the order of 23 microm centimeter will be its resistivity when it is used for the as a contact interconnect materials, okay, or contact materials. And its seed resistance in the range of 3 ohm per square for 1 micron thin film. And this polysilicon is popular, as I mentioned just now, in gate materials. Polysilicon gate process will be explained to you in CMOS process sequence class. Okay. And high temperature stability. And this is obviously an added advantage of the polysilicon contacts or polysilicon materials used as a doped polysilicon, obviously used as a contact and interconnect material. Since it is not metal, it is silicon, and its melting point is extremely high, so it has a very good temperature stability. It is stable up to, say, up to 1000 degrees centigrade and maybe sometimes more. That is an important, again, point. But aluminium contact is not stable up to that temperature. It's stable hardly, say, 500 or 400 degrees, 400 or 300 degrees centigrade up to that. Beyond that, aluminium at 500 degrees centigrade, it soften. So its stability loses. So here is one, the plus point of polysilicon contact interconnect material. N plus P plus poly for dual gate CMOS. Polysilicon can be doped to get P plus poly, and it can be doped to get N plus poly, and both poly N plus P plus are used for dual gate CMOS device as a gate material. Now, refractory metals. This is another class of contact interconnect materials, and the refractory metals commonly used materials used in VLSI process are chromium, palladium, tungsten. Chromium, palladium, tungsten, these three materials are, and also another material which is molybdenum. Molybdenum, chromium, palladium, tungsten, those are used in different metallization schemes for different purpose. Some cases it is used for getting good adherence, some cases it is used for preventing undesired diffusion from one layer to other layer. So different purpose, different films are, refractory metal films are used. All the refractory metals has a very high temperature stability compared to aluminium. High temperature stability used mainly as a reaction barrier, just as I mentioned, diffusion barrier, as I told you. So reaction barrier. So to stop the reaction between one layer to other layer, some intermediate layer, refractory metal layers is introduced. Okay, that is one of the application, one of the use of the refractory metal films. CVD, tungsten, mid-gap work function, dual gate CMOS application. CVD is another technique which is used for depositing the metal films that I mentioned in CVD class also. And there I mentioned one CVD tungsten cross-section schematic chart structure, SCM schematic structure you have seen. So that CVD tungsten has got mid-gap work function, and it uses in dual gate CMOS. Why? For adjusting the threshold voltage. Because work function is the important parameter for adjustment of threshold voltage in CMOS. Now coming refractory silicides. That we'll discuss, the silicides we'll discuss in the metallization chapter itself. And this is another class of contact and interconnect materials, and which is frequently used in self-aligned process or silicide technology. And silicide also have higher conductivity, and not obviously is equal to the aluminium or gold, more than that, but sometimes moderate resistivity or moderate conductivity you can achieve in some cases. And in case of tungsten silicide, one example is given, 70 micron centimeter. Palladium silicide, its resistivity is 30 micron centimeter. But if you use the titanium and cobalt silicide, those are very much popular in VLSI process. And cobalt and titanium silicide has got resistivity in the range of 15 to 18 microhm centimeter, even lower than tungsten and palladium. So refractory silicides has moderate resistivity, good high temperature stability. High temperature stability in this case, polysilicon or in refractory metals or refractory silicides are available because their melting points is very high. Because all these three materials, melting point is almost double in some cases, three times that of aluminium in normal metals. So that is why in all these three cases, means in polysilicon, refractory metals or refractory silicide, we get high temperature stability. Potential replacement for poly as gate metallization. In earlier days, polysilicon gate were used, but now in modern silicide process, the silicide gates are used instead of polysilicon gate, because silicide gate has got certain advantage of self-alignment. I will discuss that point. So, refractory metal silicides are potential replacement for poly as gate metallization. Okay? These are the some of the metallization schemes I just discussed: aluminium, gold, polysilicon, refractory metals, and refractory silicides. Now, I am giving you a table where the relative comparison of various properties are shown, where the rho is resistivity, Tm is the melting point of that metal, alpha is the thermal expansion coefficient, whose unit is ppm per degree centigrade, reaction with silicon, that means annealing temperature, when the metallurgical compatible reaction will take place, where the it is soluble to have a ohmic contact. So that reaction temperature is shown here. That means after patterning of the metal film, you have to go for annealing, and that annealing temperature is mentioned here, which is known as reaction temperature with silicon. And the third column is the stable on silicon, that means up to what temperature that particular metallization schemes are stable. So that is stable on silicon, and these are temperature in degree centigrade. Now you can compare different values for aluminium, molybdenum, tungsten, titanium, these are all metals. Then in silicide, I put two silicide here, titanium silicide and cobalt silicide, which are very much popular in VLSI technology nowadays. Then coming nitride, titanium nitride and tantalum nitride. Then comes carbide, titanium carbide and tantalum carbide. That means carbides, nitrides, silicides and pure metal. The four categories of the metal or alloys are mentioned here, and their properties are shown. And out of all this, you can see here, aluminium has got minimum resistivity, the highest conductivity here. So 2.7 to 3 microhm centimeter is its resistivity. Its melting point is low, 660 degree centigrade, whereas the melting point of others are higher. Tungsten in the range of 3000 degree centigrade, molybdenum more than 2000 degree centigrade, and titanium more than 1500 degree centigrade. And nitride and carbides, obviously, all of them will have melting point more than 3000 degree centigrade. And the next column shows the thermal expansion coefficient. Here, aluminium has 25 ppm per degree centigrade, molybdenum only 5. Tungsten 4.5 and titanium 8.5. Titanium silicide at 12.5 and cobalt silicide 10.14 ppm per degree centigrade. These are thermal expansion coefficient. Now the reaction temperature. Reaction temperature means at what temperature you are going to have the good contact. That's annealing temperature. Aluminium within 250 degree centigrade, whereas molybdenum and tungsten needs higher temperature, 400 to 700 degree centigrade. But nitride and carbide, it require 450 to 500 degrees centigrade annealing temperature for good reaction with silicon. And stability temperature, high temperature stability are compared also in the last column. Aluminium is stable up to 250 degrees centigrade, whereas molybdenum and tungsten are stable up to 400 to 600 degrees centigrade. And other titanium nitrides are stable up to 450 degrees centigrade. Okay, these are some comparisons. And this particular table shows why aluminium is a favorite material for VLSI contact and interconnects. These are the few points of aluminium: its favor, low resistance, 2.7 ohm micron centimeter, non-rectifying contacts to P and N plus silicon, good contacts to thin film nichrome and other solvent materials, high conductivity, good adhesion. It does not require any other metal for improvement of adhesion, high density of interconnect possible, but the problems are with shallow emitter VLSI. If the junctions are shallow, very shallow, then aluminium is not a very good material for that. Electromigration and corrosion, that is again problem with aluminium. I will discuss this particular point in detail later on. And then aluminium silicon alloy is used, it limits depth of alloying. Instead of pure aluminium, sometimes aluminium silicon alloys are used in order to prevent certain problems and certain failure mechanisms, and those failure mechanisms I will discuss little bit in a depth. Okay, so these are few points which are favorable for selection of aluminium, and that is why for quite a considerable amount of time in VLSI technology, aluminium has taken a key role in metallization process. And even now, aluminium is used with addition of certain other materials or films, that means aluminium alloy, not pure aluminium. Okay? And one is aluminium silicon alloy, sometimes use aluminium silicon copper alloy, some amount of copper, maybe 1, 2, or 3% of copper is mixed with them. So that is also sometimes used. Why those alloys are used and what are the advantages, that will be mentioned in those failure and problem class, problem topic. Okay, so let me stop here. In the next class, we will continue on metallization techniques, technology of metallization, what are the different technology used for getting thin films of metal, various metals. And we'll concentrate mainly on aluminium, okay? Because aluminium has got more good points compared to other materials. And most of the ICs, we need stability up to 250 or 300 degrees centigrade is okay. And aluminium is stable up to 250 degrees centigrade, is quite enough. But those cases where the operation temperature or IC is used at very high temperature, there aluminium is not a good metallization scheme. Then we have to search for other metallization schemes. Okay, so next class we will discuss on the various techniques, technology of getting the aluminium film.
Thank you.